Leo, it's great to meet you.
Thank you so much.
Again, we all admire so much what you've accomplished. I got to start with that Olympic race, which I still see in my head. You really bring the whole come from behind win thing to a new level. This is a 1500 meter race. 400 meters to go, you're in 10th place, where all of us in this room would be. We'd hope to be in 10th place, out of 12. Then with about 200 meters to go, you're now in 8th place. And yet you finish in 2nd place, much to the shock of everybody in the stadium and everybody watching on TV. Can we play? We're going to play the actual race so you see what we're talking about. Yeah. I must say, tiny Texan, the tiny Texan.
With the Ferrari engine, of course.
With the Ferrari engine. It's absolutely incredible to see that again. I mean, it's like watching the same movie over and over and hoping for the same ending. We know it's the same ending. It's great. I need to know what's going on in your head while all that's going on. What kind of interior monologue or dialogue are you having with yourself while all that's going on?
Right. Well, it's very, very intense, actually. With 400 meters to go, I was in no man's land, as we call it, and really in the back. And it was kind of a point in the race where I thought I was done. My legs felt like they were going to fall off. My lungs and my heart felt like they were going to explode. And there was a point in the race where I started thinking about all the sacrifice that I had made throughout my life, and about how much time I had put into this time for this particular moment.
Yep.
I started thinking about my friends, my family, and just all the people in support of me that were back home.
So that's all going through your mind?
Yes, with 400 meters to go.
With 400 meters to go.
And as soon as I said that, as soon as I started thinking to myself about all the sacrifice, it was like something clicked in my head, and I was like, no, I have to fight. I can't give up. I have to fight for every minute, for every second, until the last second. Right about then, my legs, my arms started really moving. With 300 meters to go, I make this move to the outside. I kind of get blocked. I come back in. It seems like something just like I had an opening, so I went for it.
Yep.
With 200 meters to go, I'm passing this gentleman named Nick Willis, who has a very, very, very good closing speed. But I'm passing him on the outside, and as you guys know, usually when you run on the outside, you're running further. But I'm passing him, and for a split second, I was like, "Oh my God, it's Nick Willis! I'm passing him."
Right.
But of course, I couldn't stay there. I got to keep going because it was still 200 meters till the race.
Right.
With 100 meters to go, I'm in sixth place. And about then, I knew, it's like, I still have a little more to go. And I almost kind of went into like a praying / talking to myself. And I said to myself, I can do this. I can do this. I really think I can.
Yep.
And with 50 meters to go, I just put on the nitro and took off across the finish line, and we brought home an Olympic medal.
So it is psychological. The rest of us know that, but we don't win medals. You actually win. It's an amazing thing. So there's the legend and the lore of Leo Manzano, it begins with your unusual running shoes, the running shoes you had as a boy.
Yes, sir.
Can you talk about that and tell us how you discovered your love of running?
Well, growing up, I come from a very, very modest background, and so my family didn't really have a lot of money to buy shoes or track gear. So I show up to the first day of practice with work boots and kind of some pants, and still managed to run.
Somehow, probably faster than everybody, even in boots, as it
turns
out. Amazing. Now, so this tiny Texan thing that I'm so enamored of from the announcer, you are actually just under 5 feet, 5 inches.
I like to say I'm 5'5", but I'm 5'4 and a half.
If we measured you, you would actually, it would not come up. So you don't have the typical height or the typical build of a middle distance runner, and yet it seems like despite your achievements, you've had to work really hard to get proper recognition. Maybe it's because of your size, right? Does it get frustrating to be cast always as the underdog, or have you learned how to turn that around to your advantage?
You know, I think at first it was a little frustrating, but I've kind of learned that it actually plays to my advantage because they don't exactly know when I'm coming.
Right, they underestimate you, right? Isn't that it? Right, right.
Yes.
Right.
So,
it's kind of, it's good. It's a good way to think about it. So you've now actually been in two different Olympic Games, right? You've been in the Beijing Olympics in 2008 right out of college.
Yes, sir.
And then again in 2012 in London when you won the silver medal. So you're literally achieving literally the American dream. This is not just a phrase.
Yes, sir.
It is the American dream. What does that feel like to represent the country? We'll never get a chance to do that. Tell us what that's like.
It's incredible. I mean, it's an honor. You know, my family came to the U.S. from Mexico when I was four. You know, growing up, we didn't have a lot of money, and just being able to be in the sport and to have gone to the University of Texas and to go on to the 2008 Olympics. At the time, I felt like I was just a kid.
Yeah.
And you know, I did fall a little short, but
you were there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
And I really think that it was because of the University of Texas. Without the University of Texas, the silver medal would probably not be in the U.S. today.
It's because of the opportunity you had here and the training you received here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's just amazing. All right, so last time, this is something that actually is a big thing for me. So last time I looked, you have nearly 11,000 followers on Twitter. You and I are kind of like neck and neck, the only time in our entire lives that we're going to be neck and neck. And you have more than 14,500 fans on Facebook. You post messages in both English and Spanish. And given your age, the fact that you're into social media, you are of this century. It makes perfect sense.
Yes, sir.
But talk about why this is important to you. Why is social media, being on these networks, important to somebody like you?
Well, first of all, I think it allows me the opportunity to connect very closely with my followers. And of course, I'm very fortunate enough to have people and honored that they would follow me.
Yeah.
But I'm able to, you know, really bring many experiences. For example, when I was growing up, I had never traveled outside of the U.S. or really Mexico. And so I get to travel the world, and one moment I'll be, say, in Switzerland, or the next moment I'll be in France. So I get to bring live photos of where I'm at.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I get to do very cool events like the Blue Santa of Austin. I was able to be the Grand Marshal in their parade.
Give back?
Yes, sir.
Right.
And then, of course, at the Olympics.
Yeah. So. Well, and how nice that you get to be a role model for little Leo Manzanos to come, right? You didn't have that many people you could look up to in the same way, but now suddenly they can look up to you.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that great? So we're going to show the cover of Austin Fit magazine. You told a very funny story in this article about an awkward double date you were on when you were a student at UT. I'm going to make you tell that story to the audience.
So... So my girlfriend at the time is had just shown up to my house, and we're getting ready to leave. I'm opening the door, and as I'm opening the door, the USADA person happens to be standing.
These are the drug testing people.
The drug testing person.
The ones,
yes,
who come and ask for your urine all,
yes,
of a sudden.
Yes, sir. And he is there for a sample, and I had actually just gone to the restroom.
So A, you have a date there, and B, couldn't go.
I couldn't go, yes.
Right.
So I was like, oh, hey, how's it going? You're here, hey. So we ended up going back to the couch. I went over to the refrigerator, started just drinking a lot of water. And we turned on the TV, turned on to CNN, and watching some TV. And the next thing I know, I mean, it's a little awkward. You know?
Yeah, I can imagine. Right.
And after about 20, 30 minutes, I still can't go. And then... you know, our time for our reservation was coming up, and so, you know, we actually had to take the guy with us. So, long story short,
that's a heck of a date. Let me,
yes,
tell you what.
Yes.
She'll never forget that.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, long story short, after a while, I was able to go, but it was very interesting.
So. Yeah. Say to the audience, bet you didn't expect us to talk about that, did you? All right, so come back to the charitable work you've done and the giving back, which is so,
yes,
wonderful. In 2010, you established the Manzano Mile,
yes, sir,
to support young people and charitable programs. Talk about the event and talk about why you started.
So through my travels in Europe, I was... Track and field is amazing in Europe.
Yep.
And they bring a whole new aspect to track and field,
right,
live music, and just a very fun and family-oriented event or events.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to bring that to the U.S. and at the same time be able to provide certain charities or certain groups with free entries for their kids to come run for free.
How great.
And at the same time, we also fundraise some money for these certain charities or organizations.
What a nice deal. Don't have to do that, but how great that you do. You also don't have to still live here. You know, you've accomplished so much. You could live anywhere. Yes, you could train anywhere, but you live right here in Austin, Texas. You train here in Austin. What did it mean to receive a scholarship and an education to be at UT Austin specifically, but what does this community mean to you?
So, you know, I was the first person in my family to graduate from college. And, you know, for me, graduating from college was huge. And, right, of course, for my family, again, I'm able to kind of, it's like a stepping stone for us.
Yeah.
And to have received a scholarship from the University of Texas to run on the track team, it was just a blessing.
It made everything possible.
It did. Yeah. And then also to receive a college education, I mean, it's for me and for my family, I mean, that was beyond belief.
Can't run forever.
Exactly. Correct.
But you now have an education that after you're done, you'll be able to put to great use.
Yes, sir.
And again, what a great life you've had. What a remarkable life. It is so great to meet you. Still young, his great career still going so strong, but what a wonderful future you have beyond that. Everybody in this room is going to root for you, and we hope that you go to the next Summer Olympics and this time bring back gold.
I will.
All right. Leo Manzano, thank you very much. Great. Really nice to know you. Good. All right. Thank you very much.